Well, thanks a lot for the invitation. Thanks everyone for seeing the film. Do you see me if I sit or is it better if I stand? Okay. So actually I was asked to, so how many of you are directors? Okay, and producers? And actors? Okay. So I didn't expect the actors, so I will try and incorporate all aspects, but I would really also like you to ask me questions about things that you are interested in, because then I can, you know, talk about how I worked on this film and okay. But maybe just briefly, you know, I explained it to when they asked me to do it, when they asked me to teach in film school in Switzerland, I always ask myself, you know, what can I give to students, or what is the position of teaching students, film students, directors about cinema? And I think there's a lot of ways of making films, and there are certain rules, but there's no recipes really in making films, and I always feel that the more personal you are, or the more you in a way also know what you want to tell to a public, the better the films are. So I tell my students that I think it's good if you either so if you either, you know, you have, so it's you either make films about a world that you really know, you know, your own surrounding, your films that play in the place you're from, in a family that you kind of know about. You talk about a friendship that you had, because you can explore from your own from your own experiences, and it gives you a ground, you know, and because there's so many phases when you make films. There's the idea you have, and then you start working on the script, that's a skill, and then you start financing your film, that's a skill. So a lot of different levels you have to work on, and it just gives you a stronger ground if you either in a way know, have experienced what you talk about, or if you really create your own world, you know, a very subjective world. There's and I'm sure maybe some of you are more in one direction, others in the other. There's directors like, for example, the Coen brothers. They always create their own universe, which is, it's not very real, but it's theirs. And they, you know, they built it in a very, very serious and concise way. But you enter another world. Or when you watch Almodovar, or even Lars von Trier, you know, it's not something that they lived in their everyday life, but something they really needed to get out of their body, heart, and soul. And they created a very clear universe. So that's kind of a basic for me, a starting point in making a film. Do I talk about something I really know and I transport into a story, or do I build a whole other universe? And for me, so far, my films have always been, people ask me, you know, is it autobiographical? And I say, they're not one-to-one autobiographical, but I talk about certain feelings and problems and issues that are very close to my inner world. So that's how I start making a film. But now I wanted to ask you, is there something that struck you yesterday in the film that you really thought was interesting for you, or that was kind of stupid for you that you want to talk about? It can also be critical, you know. It doesn't have to be like, yeah, you made a nice film. Is there what struck you, or what was maybe close to you or completely foreign to you? So maybe then we can, you know, start from one point. Yes.
interesting about the film was the way you used it. So it seems like a very personal story, but also the use of genre, like this thriller genre. So that was what struck me, what I thought was very, very exceptional about the film. So I was wondering how did that came, like what came first? Like, I want to make a thriller, or maybe it's weird of me to think there are two different things, or not as much different, but I found the combination exciting, actually.
Well, actually, you know, when my short film Hotel Belgrade, the documentary Yugo Divas and Fräulein always dealt with people who come from one country and are placed into another, really that outer identity thing. Where do you belong, and with your passport, with your, you know, surroundings? So I said, okay, this is enough. You know, I made my three films. I'm going to do a thriller now. And people said, are you sure? Because you're not that type. And I said, I don't care. I really want that. And, you know, I heard about the story because it's inspired by a true incident. So a cousin told me about two girls who went on the Petka mountain. It's a mountain I know well because my grandmother lives just, I watch it from her window. And only one came back. And it gave me a bit of a spooky feeling, like, and I thought, what happened really? Or do I want to explore what happened? Or is it, but it was a bit going in the thriller direction. So I said, okay, I'm going to do a genre film. And then I started writing. And I must say, I realized that it's just not me, you know. I still am, in a way, dealing with subjects of female identity, of identity, of belonging, of family identity. So I decided to take this kind of anecdotes and build a very personal universe around. And what I do, I work very visually. So I can't, for example, write a script in my head, like imagine it in my head and then write it down in 2 weeks. But what I work a lot with photography, with photographs and with drawings. I don't draw particularly well, but I make sketches, and it helps me in a way to visualize also, to see how I want to build a film. So I had this kind of, I said, from the thriller, I'll use a couple of aspects, you know, or from the horror thriller, you have, you know, the woods, it's very classic. Then you have the empty corridors. I really made a list for myself, you know, what thriller and horror is. And then, in a subtle way, it's inside. Most of the people do sense that spooky feeling in the film, and in a way where I make my life a bit harder is that I say, I don't want to stick one-to-one to the genre, but I want to kind of make it my own so it fits to the story. And so one aspect was this inspiration, then elements like the forest and the corridors, and also in the sound. The sound is in a way very empty, but also sharp. So you, in moments, you have the sense that there is something behind one of the characters, even if you don't see it. And I also experiment a lot when I write. So I change the scenes a lot. Also when I edit, I edit it for quite a long time to kind of find that balance between atmosphere and genre, between reality and fantasy. Sorry. Yeah. I can later, and if you're interested, I can show you the mood boards that I made for the film, because I can't really verbalize from the beginning and say, you know, I wanted the film to be handheld from the beginning, and then I want the colors to be brownish. But I look at a lot of pictures, and then I kind of place them together like in a puzzle, and it's like a puzzle becoming the film at the end. That's how I, približavam se. I get closer to what I really want.
I just wanted to hear more about your frame rate choice. It just, because it was interesting, and I had some things in my mind, so I want to hear from you. What was your reference or reason of your choice? Because it was like, it had that home video looking. So if you can talk about that.
Can you explain, how do you mean home video, or the ratio, I mean, the where I use close-ups and...
Oh, you mean, I think it was like 30 frame rate, like 30 frames per second, so it's like faster, so like as opposed to 24, the classic look?
Not really.
Wasn't it?
No, we used, it's 24 frames a second, it's shot on an Alexa.
Okay.
Did you have the feeling that some scenes were slowed down? Ah, yeah, well, like I mean, there's like...
On the cliff, like it looked like more home video looking.
Yeah. You wanted to know why I did that?
Yeah.
For example, so there's one scene, I don't know if you saw it, but in the... When she rides on the bike with Ivo, they ride up to that caserne, to that where the army is. We made it faster, the image, because it was, you know, we were driving without helmets on a street that is rather dangerous, and it was difficult finding an actor who can also ride a bike and who says, okay, I'm going to take a 14-year-old in the back up those. And also, insurance-wise, it's not really something you're allowed to do. So they were driving actually pretty slowly, and then we had to make it faster. And for the shots of the cliff, those are subjective moments, you know, because they're not there. They're in her imagination. So it helped slowing the image down, or the intent was that it helps slowing the image down, that you kind of have that bit sense of, wow, you know, almost like, do I want to jump or not? Mm-hmm. So it's really kind of underlining the emotion where she's at. Mm-hmm. And that's also how, in a way, how I try to build the film. It's Linda's story, it's from her perspective, but obviously, you know, I didn't want to make a film with just point of view where I kind of from out of her eye, where I follow her story, but kind of finding the mixture of subjective, very personal moments and the narrative of the story that I, for myself, you know, I always need, I call them islands, kind of elements that I say, this is important to me, and then I write them down, like 7 elements, because I once heard that Kubrick always had 7, that he was working with 7 scenes for a film, and that those 7 scenes were kind of how he, they were his structure. And he built it the rest around. And I feel, you know, there's a lot you can read about cinema, a lot of books, a lot of anecdotes. And I took maybe 20 I liked, and then I made them, I adapted them to myself. So one was, and I lost the thing, what is subjective? When was I the last? Oh, I lost the subjective. Mm. Well, it will come if it was important, but... Yeah, does that answer
Yeah, thanks.
Yes. And also, sorry, today in editing, it's also, you can, you know, I edited on a Final Cut. I wouldn't do it anymore. I would use Avid, but I did it on a Final Cut. And you can flip images, you can slow down very easily. And as the film is shot digital and post-production is digital, it doesn't cost, like in the old days when you shot on film, it doesn't cost in the lab anymore, so you can experiment a lot with that, or you can just do those things in editing, and then you have them on screen in a good quality, which is, it's also a dangerous time because you start, you know, doing a lot of effects.
I was just gonna ask something about the character development, because your character is slowly losing the connection with reality, just like in Polanski's The Tenant or Aronofsky's Black Swan. What kind of, if you did psychological research before you developed this kind of psychological, I don't know, work with the character? And if you did, what kind of a preparation did you do with the actor? Because she's quite young. Yeah.
So the challenge in this film was that I said, you know, I want this outer story that is pretty simple. It's about a girl returning home but it's not really her home, and she doesn't know who she is, and she starts exploring who she is. And then there's, you know, you can in a way interpret it, she has to kill someone in order to find herself, or by her best friend dying by an accident, she kind of explores herself via her identity. And I didn't know about psychology before, not too much, but a bit. I talked to also for my life, for other films. I'm a curious person. I know a couple of analysts, so I always constantly ask them things, you know, how, what their patients tell them. And I'm just very interested in the interior world, but I don't do very academic research. It's not that I sit down and I say, okay, what's schizophrenia? What's I know from own experiences in the family, people who are mentally ill. So that's also why I had to go a bit into psychology. But and then, so I talked to kind of friends who are psychoanalysts, and I asked them questions, you know, what do people do when, just one thing to go back. So reading the story, you know, in the outer story, for me, Linda doesn't kill Etta, it's an accident. But the inner story is she kills her, because in that moment she brings her to a moment where she can't do anything else but push. So I asked on both levels questions, you know, what would be if you do something like that? Would you return to the family? It's like the murderer going back often. It's also in Dostoevsky's Crime and Punishment, you have that. The murderer often goes back to the place he did it out of. And I also always said it's not a film for me about guilt, because it's, I mean, the film is in a way her, you know, how she deals with the fact, with the terrible fact that happened. And I also asked a lot of questions about, actually I did research. There's also one thing called Familienroman. It's like one part of psychology says that, you know, stories within the family repeat themselves. If something terrible happens in your grandmother's or grandfather's generation and you don't talk about this, it goes to the other generation in different ways. Freudians call that hobby psychology, but there is something to it when you have family secrets. I research a lot about family secrets, because in my culture, I feel that you don't talk about a lot of the bad things that happen, but they're always in the air somewhere. You know, you feel them. They're in behind the walls. They stay. And so I did that about murders, about family taboos. And I also obviously watched the films where this either identity or getting crazy moment comes. And the Polanski's film was, it's really a great film, was one of them. And for the young girls, so I said I really want to work with 14-year-olds. So when I did the casting, I cast 12, 13-year-olds, because I knew it would last till the shooting. And I also asked myself, you know, how am I going to tell them this thing of outer story, inner story when you're 13? I mean, it's like they look at you. But they understand a lot. So I didn't talk about psychology, but I talked about there's also this one theory that says to actors, you have to talk in like action verbs, you know, you have to talk direct. You can't say, yeah, you know, go into the room, let's say, well, I have to find an example. Go into the room and feel happy. It's very abstract, but if you say, go into the room and you're not allowed to fall, but it's slippery, something more concrete, you know, it's always easier. So I try to be concrete about the scenes, but I talked a lot about also my background and why I want to make this film and what, in a way, the atmosphere of it is, that, you know, I want it a bit spooky. And then I asked them, have you ever, you know, fantasized about pushing your best friend? Fantasized. And then the first thing is like, oh no, you know, I would never, ever fantasize about that. Okay, then you talk more, and then suddenly this thing comes. Yeah, I remember, you know, yesterday my best friend, she said that she doesn't want to go to the movies with me, and I really wanted to kill her, and I was like, yes, no, that's it. So it was with them building trust at the beginning. So I really wanted that they trusted me. So I also talked about me and also showed my vulnerable side. Not, I didn't come in as a, so now I know what we do and you have to undress yourself. And I was amazed how much they understand, you know, and how much in a way they're like sponges and they really wanted to be in this film. So they, in a way, they started looking behind my thoughts also. They really got the psychology by also watching me and kind of listening to what I was telling them. It was interesting. Also for Etta, at the beginning, Lucia, who plays Etta, the girl who falls and dies, she was obviously very enthusiastic getting the part, and it's in this small town, Dubrovnik, and I looked at all the girls and she was chosen and she had a driver, so she felt like the star. And then when we started rehearsing, we did rehearsals with Leon Lutsev, who plays Linda's father in the film. He works, he was here too, wasn't he? Yeah. And they were so scared of him. They were so scared of him because, you know, he came, and then we knew we wanted to do physical work with them, because in a lot of movies where you have 14-year-olds, they're played by 18-year-olds. Because a lot of films about 14-year-olds are about awakening of sexuality, and then you have 18-year-olds who kind of know already a bit, who played, and it's easier for them. And for my two girls, it was always new, you know, and they were really scared of everything, of kissing, of the scene with Ivo was terrifying for Linda. She hasn't even imagined holding a hand of a boy and not going home with a 20-year-old older man. So we had to, with Leon, we said we were going to work on the physical side so that they, once they, you know, scream and that they kiss and that they stand in front and say who they are, and that they once sense how when it's when they get angry, you know, when it's how it is when they caress each other, not just for the film but to kind of connect. And that was good. And then when we came to the cliff, you know, and I explained to Etta how we were going to do it, we had security. She started to cry. She really started to cry very from the bottom of your heart, because she had to die. And she identified already, and she really thought that she knew that we were not gonna throw her over the cliff, but it was stronger. She was really crying because she had to die. And in a way, it's a mixture, you know. I have a son, he's 6, and kids love playing, and they can really identify quickly with the game, and then, or he can be very sad, very upset. And then the next second, when I say, okay, no, you can do it, you know, he switches and he's happy. So this, because I was first scared, how can I change the feelings? I felt bad saying, you know, now you have to be happy and now sad and now you die and then you come back. But then I realized it's a bit like with children, it's also a joy of changing emotions and changing identity for them, yeah. Maybe a question of a producer. The total budget of the film was 2.3 million euros. And it was a co-production. It was a majority production out of Switzerland, where I have my company with my partner. And then it was co-produced by Croatia and Bosnia. And also we had Örimash funding. And it was, for this project, it was interesting because the co-production was kind of natural. It was in the story of the film. Because usually when you do co-productions, you do them for financial reasons most of the time, and then you have to go and shoot in another country or take cast from another country. And here it was later in producing, it was a bit easier because it made sense that we had Bosnian, that we had Croatian actors or Bosnian crew because of the language also. And because my last film was quite successful, it wasn't, I would say with the script, it was this time it wasn't so hard to convince the funds. Yes, maybe going back when I did my first film, Fräulein, the producers forced me to go to EAVE with a script doctor. And I came home and I hated it. It was terrible because I had a script doctor who wasn't on, didn't like the same films. And I think a script doctor or an advisor or a dramaturg is really helpful, but it has to be somebody you share a certain taste with and you share a certain vision with, or somebody really you like a lot, but it has to be somebody who is close to you. Unless you say, okay, I want to make the genre film, it just has to be really, you know, flashy and conventional, then you can work with a good script advisor, even if you don't have the same taste. But if you want to do film d'auteur, if you're more in the art house section, you have to find people who you share things with. And then it was terrible because the script got really worse and worse and worse, and I didn't know anymore what to do. And then at some point, I really threw away all those versions and went back to the last one before the EAVE session. And then I said, I will never, ever work with a script doctor again because I'm not sick. My script is not sick. You know, I need people inspiring me. And then for this new film, for Cure, Jasmila Žbanić, the director, she organized a workshop with Roland Zack, who is a German script advisor. And we were a group of six people and we worked on a very personal level. You know, a lot talking also about our experiences, doing exercises on each other's scripts, and that was very helpful. And those exercises I use also when I work with my students. So that was super because it was not so much about recipes, but kind of yourself finding out more about your story. So, yeah, it's my relationship is a bit ambiguous, but I do feel when you find someone who you connect, you know, it's helpful because they can see it from the outside. But it's also fragile because you can't give your script out too early because sometimes you're too much on the inside, and then when somebody from the outside comes and says, oh, you know, the first turning point doesn't work, it can be destructive also for the script. So the script has to be at a point where you kind of know it very well and then you can give it out.
That's what it said in the...
Yes, I wrote it with Marie Kreutzer. She's an Austrian director and scriptwriter, and I knew it from Fräulein. She had worked on the last draft of that script. So I really had also a personal, very good relationship with her. I like her style. And then she worked on the treatment. I wrote the first treatment, and then she rewrote it, and then she wrote the first draft of the script. And then Thomas, who is my partner, and he also co-produced the film with me, he was more involved in the structure of the film and being a pain, you know, the critical, like, and in a way also trying to always push me back to what I really want. Because I feel it depends a bit, you know, if you want to make really commercial films or more arthouse films. In arthouse films, you also have to do with a lot of people and everyone has an opinion. And everybody will tell you, you know, here maybe change the character, or are you sure you want to tell the story in this town and not somewhere else? Or have you thought about a genre? Or a lot of questions. And sometimes it's hard not to get lost because you work with so many people. So then it's important that somebody always tells you, you know, is it really what you want? There's another anecdote another one of the things that I took from all the books I read is that, I don't remember who, but maybe you know, one guy scriptwriter said he always writes the essence of his film onto a sheet, onto a card, puts it in a in an envelope, seals it, and puts the envelope in a drawer. And when he, on the way, writing the script, I would say everyone gets lost at some point. It's normal. Then he goes back, opens the drawer, you know, and sees what at that time was the essence when he or started writing it. And I kind of like that image. So I do that too. You know, it can be, I actually, no, it's getting more complicated. I have like my five islands, so it's really simple. But for this film, it was grandma's house, because that gave me the feeling of my grandmother also, of the spookiness of the fairy tale. Then I had forest. Then I had Dubrovnik soul, which for me is kind of the darker part of Dubrovnik. And every time I looked at it, I didn't have it in a drawer. I put them like islands on my wall. I looked at it, I knew that I shouldn't forget telling also about kind of the atmosphere of the town. And I had war. And girls' friendships. But I call them darkly feminine friendships. And in Fräulein, I had loneliness, one word. On a paper, not in an envelope. So what is your interest? Do you know it already? Is it towards kind of personal, your own stories? Do you have your subjects already, or are you looking for them? Or is it clear that you want to do genre Hollywood films? Hollywood? Who is Hollywood? Who knows their subject or their...
I think I know the essence of my film. Maybe it's the only thing I have now. it's about finding yourself along the way and becoming yourself. And that's why it's interesting that your film is also is about identity and in a way finding yourself, because it's a coming of age film at the same time. Yeah. Is there anything you want to ask?
Yeah, I was interested because when I work with my students, I often see that at the beginning, even if they study directing, they actually don't know their subjects yet, which is also, it's normal that they're kind of looking for what really interests them or that they find interesting, that in a way they either have to find a really good story that as itself works already or create their own universe. I lived in New York 7 years before making Fräulein, and then because I was writing and I was really depressed because it got worse and worse. So I said, okay, I'm going to go to New School to a cinema course to get inspiration. And it was a course actually really, then a friend thought about the Coen brothers and their subject and their universe. That's when I heard the term about creating your own universe. And one example I really liked, we watched Fargo. Do you know Fargo?
Yeah.
And there, for example, they also have their elements. And if you remember the film, it's actually everything is really slow. So you have the snow that is, you know, kind of gives a calmness to things. Then she's pregnant. So when you're that far pregnant, you become a bit slow. The way she eats, it's slow. And even if you re-watch the film, there's a moment when somebody shoots, the bullet even is slow. You know, it's not like, it's the bullet is slow. So they really create their own universe. And we analyzed all their films because all have a different universe. But to me, that helped. So I do that too. I write on the wall what my universe is. And then when I get lost on the way, I look at my wall and, you know, it doesn't help all the time. Sometimes I look at it and I'm like, oh, shit. what am I gonna do with this wall? And yes.
Hello, my name is Andra. I was wondering, how do you combine production with directing? You produce your own projects, or you are constantly searching for young directors?
Well, when I the previous film Fräulein I did with a producer, the same one I did the documentary with, and it was, I felt a bit at times exposed and not really being able to take certain important decisions with them, because I was at the end just a director, and I wrote the script and I was really pushing the project further. But when it came to productional decisions, I didn't have the right, in a way. I could tell what I wanted, but they had the final say. And then I realized that for me, making film and producing really goes together, because and there's different models, obviously. When you find, as a director, you find a producer, you really get along well and you work together, it's super, because you can concentrate more on the directing work. But it doesn't always work ideally. And I felt, decisions like, do I want to shoot 10 weeks instead of 6? And then what do I have to do? Where do I have to cut if I shoot for 10 weeks? Do I have to cut scenes, or do I have to change the story, or do I have to work with non-actors? Those are all very creative decisions, and also produce. I mean, it goes together with me, for me. Yeah. And also, the tendency is that we shoot faster, that people don't have time to edit. I also, on the previous film, Fräulein, they said, okay, it's picture cut now. And, they're okay producers. They said, you have to lock the picture. And I showed it to a friend that night, an Austrian director and producer, and he was sitting there, and he said, no. It was terrible. I had picture lock, he came, and he said, no, this is not it. You have to take a break and then add 2 weeks. And I said, they will kill me if I tell them. And actually, they didn't kill me. It was okay. I got my 2 weeks. But editing is, in a way, the cheaper part. I mean, today we edit on Final Cut. We can edit at home. If you have an editor, they will also see and maybe work 1 week for free. So it's not the very expensive part of the filmmaking process. And I felt so, in a way, tired fighting about those small things all the time. That was also one reason. And then I also wanted the film to belong to me, that I, in distribution, I could make certain choices where I want to screen the film, where I want to sell the film. And there is this tradition in Europe, a lot of directors, they produce their own films. You have that with the Dardenne, you have that with Almodovar, with Van Trier, you have that with Fatih Akin, the German one. They all are also producers. It's, in a way, taking also responsibility as a director and being able to then also say, okay, if I, I want it like this, and then think, if I shoot longer, I have to give something else up. So it goes a bit together for me. And I also like this philosophy of those associations where you have both, as a director and producer. And then when I formed it with Thomas Imbach, he's also my husband now, but filmmaker, a director. We didn't want to stay just the two of us. We wanted a pool of people. But in Switzerland, it wasn't that easy to find, because the directors really wanted to direct and the producers already had their company. So there wasn't the spirit of, yes, let's have this platform. It was supposed to be this platform of producers, directors together, and a bit more of a liberal and artistic spirit than most of the producers have, which is normal. It's just two interests also. And so my partner's film, Thomas's film, that was in Locarno last year and in Toronto, it's called Mary, Queen of Scots. It's a period piece, a really big film that we did for not so much money. I produced, which means that during financing, we do it together. And then on the set, I'm the producer. So it's not chaotic, him being director, producer, and he can let go of certain things. And on my film, it was the same. Like, I'm responsible for raising the money and also later in post-production that everything works. But on the set, he was the producer. So people would always say, oh, yeah, the Swiss producer is flying in from Zurich to Dubrovnik. And I had to laugh a bit. But they like it. You know, the crew likes it when the producer comes and it's not director producer together. So when it's serious, everybody has their role, a single role, but in everyday business and life we do both. Yes, but also very differently. So when I write for Thomas, I like writing scenes and then I give it to him and then he kind of can do with them whatever he wants. But we can't really sit together and write because then we almost kill each other. So it's not symbiotic. So I just tell him to be brief, tell me what he wants, and then I learned that in the years. We sat so many times together and so many weekends fighting. So we said, no, this is not, we stop with this. And he, with me, it's more kind of the pain and the critical aspect of my... of me and on working more on the structure and challenging me on also why I want it, how I want to do it cinematically, because his films are rather like radical and extreme. So he's always like, you know, why I want to do certain things and if it's by convention or if I've thought of that. So he's more the kind of, not the brain, but more questioning and more the head. And I like just writing and working more intuitively. It's difficult. It's why we do it, this sadomasochistic relationship, is because there is a big level of trust, and at the end we know that we really work for each other, you know, in a way that we really want that the other one can make his film well. So that's why we do it.
And when you arrived in, you are living in Switzerland?
Yes.
Did you work for another company or did you start directly with your own project? I guess it's also more difficult to gain credibility if you are both producer, director and writer. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
So it must have been difficult for you to get the financing for your project.
Yeah. Yes, actually that is an important question. So I was first in, so I did film school in Zurich. It's a mixture of directing, camera, editing. Producing wasn't part of it, but really filmmaking, like everything. So I graduated then as a director and I did my first films with a production company. So I was known as a director and then a writer. And then when I formed Oko Film with Thomas, I mean, in a way, they couldn't say anything because I had won a big prize with the film that helped, but they hated the fact. Like, the producers, they were like, oh, no, you again, you know, these director producers who think they can do both, because in a way, it is two jobs that you do. And then, you know, we entered the producers' union, and I still, up to now, I have issues with them because I'm a woman also and because I work differently. And I think that there needs to be place for both. I really think it's great having only producers, and I think certain directors really need a producer who will be kind of an eye from the outside, do all the organization, you know, raise the money, organize people who will do the work on the shoot, and then kind of overlook the whole post-production, because it's a lot, you know, it's a long process, you know, it can take from 2 to 4 years. It's but I my choice was that I wanted to be more in this freer, that I wanted to be freer and feel freer and also take more responsibility. So up to now I have discussions with them. I had we had a reunion the other day in Locarno and it got loud. And I just think it has to, you know, it has to have place for both, in a way, both structures.
You already spoke. You gave some small pieces of this already, but you also mentioned you talked about this film school in Zurich, and previously you talked about spending several years in New York. So maybe if you could just speak a little bit about this. That has been until now, and with regards to your relationship to writing and directing, how it sort of evolved and changed. And
I didn't get the word how from the film school.
No. Just a more complete image about this. To connect this your story, just this New York and film school, and so how it. Your story.
My story.
and the regards to your relationship with writing and directing, and how it evolved and changed. And
so we have time to.
Well, yeah.
We go to dinner together, and then. So, in brief, I'm not going to start with where I was born. I'll start with film school.
Wherever you like.
No, actually, I wanted to become a photographer when I was a teenager, and I was really into photography, and I was going to the dark room and developing photos and taking a lot of pictures. And then I got accepted in London for 1 year to do a foundation course in media studies. So I went to school in the daytime. I worked at nighttime in a restaurant. And I had a really great time, because with 18, being alone in London was nice. And there, the war started in the former Yugoslavia, which for me was it was a turning point in my life, because even if I never lived in the region, I had family here, and it kind of, you know, obviously it's something aggressive and brutal that happens, where you start questioning life and who you are and what you want to do. And there in London, I felt also powerless, because I couldn't be with my family and protect them. I had powerless and bad conscience, and so I couldn't express it through photography anymore, and I decided to make a short film. So it was really a mean also for me to deal with this powerlessness and with the questions I had to, and express them by cinema. And I had a friend who co-wrote with me. He was from, I remember, Stefanos from Greece. So we made it was a bit pathetic film on video about a guy who is also looking for the sun, exactly. He was looking for the sun, kind of, and in London it was an absurd story. And but I realized that I could express via cinema certain feelings and questions that I had. And then I went back to Switzerland to start film. And it was a time when, you know, I'm born in Switzerland with a former Yugoslav background. And in that time, it was clear you were a foreigner there, point. And then some people started talking about this, and identity, like not knowing where you belong, was not a openly talked subject. It was you either were from there or you were a foreigner, point. And then there were couple of people slowly in literature and one in documentary started to talk about this thing, you know, where do you belong and can you be from one place and another? But it was not so, it was still very hidden in the media and in the film world. So when I started making films and I started talking about those subjects, people were a bit, they were like, what are you talking about? I'm very bad in pitching. When somebody says, can you pitch your project? I laugh. I'm like, ha, 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 yeah. It's for me. And once Kieslowski actually said, you have to be able to put your film into one sentence. So I really practice with every film, but then I get 10 sentences and I'm like, oh, which one is the one now? And I try hard, but I find it difficult. But it's a good thing when you can do it. So, and in film school, we actually, it was a bit strange because I did editing and sound and I knew how to operate the Nagra, you know, the old, the recording system still with the, not the digital one, but the old one. And then after 3 years, I started writing Hotel Belgrade, my thesis film, and I actually didn't know, I had an idea about writing. And there I decided I wanted, it was based on a personal experience, and I had a really good teacher there who came in, and he said, you know what, a story doesn't have to be autobiographical in order to be good, but you always have to dig inside yourself. Even if you speak about an alien who went to Ichevapchichi and then, I don't know, went to swim in the Miljatska, you never done that before, I haven't. You have to go and dig somewhere inside you, because only then characters become real. So, and he said, you have a personal story there, but it's nothing at the moment. Tell us the story. So I told the story that I, and you know, and it was very emotional, and I cried, and my fellow students cried, and it was a bit embarrassing. But then I realized, okay, the pathetic part is over, but why do I want to tell this story? And that often also happens with my students, that they have really interesting lives and stories, and then they make them a bit impersonal because they're scared of putting too many, of risking and exposing themselves also. And as a script writer, you always need to expose yourself, I think. Again, the rules are not in stone, but if you... And that's also with actors, you know, how is Linda, who is so young, how did she play, Sylvie, how did she play Linda? She put a lot of her inside this film, because it wouldn't have been possible without. It's her walking through the image, it's her entering the grandmother's house, it's her talking to the policewoman. It's so the actors expose themselves and give one part of their soul, I feel, to the film, and as a script writer, you also have to do it. So if you have the alien who goes in Ichevapchichi and goes to swim in the Miljatska, you have to ask why, you know, why am I telling this? Is it, maybe it's about loneliness, your film, and you were lonely, like I was lonely already, everybody was. Or is it about, are you angry at something? You know, maybe you're really angry about where you're from or what happened or that your girlfriend left, anything. And then kind of take that initial interest and explore it, but you have to dig inside yourself, and that is painful. So when I write, I'm always in a, not always, but it's, I find it difficult, and I get into really bad emotional moods, because it's a great process, but it's also a fragile process, and I have to put a lot of about my vulnerability also inside, which I don't like all the time. I mean, nobody likes. And then I did this short film, but I knew that I wanted to go away. I thought that when I go to New York, I will go to a place where everybody's foreign, so I will kind of find myself there. And I never been to New York before. I knew it from the films. And I had a boyfriend at the time who won a green card. So I said, let's go. You have the green card, and I know that I need to go there, you know. And then it was a bit naive, you know, with my bag, I went to New York, and then I volunteered in cinemas, and I worked for other films, and that was after 5 years of film school. So I worked on student films from the NYU, and I met a lot of really great people. But at some point, I also realized that I don't really want to talk about America. And talking about New York, I always said New York is like a place where the wind always goes through the streets. You know, people go, come and go. It's a great energy, but it's not. I didn't find stories to tell there. That's why I made a documentary Jugodivas about five Serbian female artists. That was also one of my in a way, not a mission, but I felt that women were not really portrayed from the region where I was from. It, when you saw the news, it was always men, and they were with guns, and they were ugly, and no women, and no interesting women. So I felt that for me it was natural to bring women to screen. So I did a documentary in New York, and that one I shot, I actually wrote a lot there. There's this director, Jennifer Fox. She's an American documentary director, and I went to a master class with her, and she really had taught me about how to pose questions to myself, but also to the protagonists, what I want to hear from them. So I had this black book where I wrote questions for everyone, and I kind of invented how I saw them, my biographies, and compared them to the biographies that they're real ones. And then I started, for me always, when I write, the visuals are very important. Very early I start asking myself, how do I want to tell a story? Because, you know, any story can be interesting, but it becomes personal the way you tell it. Do you tell it with just a moving camera, or with one frame, or do you tell it in a sensual way or in a rough way? That's, you give the tone for your film. So that's why I start working with photographs quite early. So when I shot the documentary, I had actually made like little screenplays for them. It was, and I wanted to shoot on film on 16 millimeter, which was much more expensive. So we had only 9 hours of material for a 1 hour film. So they were always saying, "Ah, you always tell us what to do," and it's. But they like me when I'm strict. But then they also. We always have to do what you want, and you know, we want to show us how we are nice and everything is good and we're happy. And I obviously wanted to show the other side. So. And then, you know, then there came a kind of a rough time with EAVE, with script doctors on Fräulein, with me trying to find my way, what to do with all those doctors.
This was still in New York.
Yes. And then before shooting, I knew it's good to have, but you really need somebody you're connected to and who you share something with. And then I have a couple of good books on screenplay. I have maybe 20 books that I really like, so if any of you are interested, I can send you the list, and which I think are good. And then I came, and then I shot Fräulein, and then I came back. I moved back to Switzerland. And now, you know, in a way, when I start, I will start working on the new film soon. And I have one scene now. And I think it's probably going to be different again, how I work writing. I also read that once somewhere, I don't remember where, somebody says he wrote the first draft of the script without thinking too much. You know, it's like a rough version, letting it out, like what is letting it out without thinking too much. And then obviously it's challenging how you structure that into a second draft that stays kind of with what you want to say but is more structured. But I think that first draft is really important, where you don't censor too much. And then there's my experience is between the first draft and the second is always worse. It's normal. Because people start talking to you, and then you start thinking, and you think, oh yeah, I'm making the good decisions, and you write it, and you actually lose the soul of it, always. I mean, I don't haven't experienced it differently, also from colleagues. You get a better structure, you lose the soul. And then you have to, and then it's good to go into the drawer, you know, and find your line or your picture that you put kind of with your essence. Or go back and read the first draft and see what scenes are really important to you and why, and then combine it kind of to the third draft. I for the Zure, I had a treatment. And you know what? I mean, it was when I did Fräulein, I had treatment, script, outlines, one-liners. I'm very kind of responsible person, so if a script doctor tells me, oh, you should outline your film, you know, I went home and I had a lot of time then, so I outlined. So I can show you maybe later. So I cut the lines so I can shift them around because I move the scenes. So I cut it. I had it on my wall, all those lines. And then at some point I'm like, this is great, but I don't know at all anymore what I'm talking about because I have all these one-liners. And it's also what I feel when you go from the one-liners can... At some point, I always think this is the great structure now in the one-liner, in the outline. And, you know, it's really good. Fluid, I imagine it in my head, it works. And then I go back to the treatment or to the script and I adapt them to the one-liners and it doesn't work anymore. So it is a back and forth writing also between structure and emotion and characters, kind of atmospheres. I think there's moments where you work more on structure, on the dramaturgy, and then you have to go back to the characters, and then you lose the dramaturgy again, and then you go back to the dramaturgy and the structure. So I do feel it's a fluid process. Well, Mirjana Karanović, she was already in my previous film and I really loved working with her. And when I was writing the script, Dubrovnik is a very specific town with specific tradition, people, atmosphere. And I obviously looked into actresses from there because I imagined the grandmother much older. And then there you have, today you have mostly theater actresses. And they're not so used in film, and they're very theatrical, the 2, 3, 4 that are there. And then I realized that it's good to be authentic, but if I have to choose between a person from Dubrovnik who doesn't fit the psychology or the character really, and somebody who is not from there but will play it, I go for the better, for the more interesting actress for that part. And it was also there are not too many 80-year-old actresses. And then Thomas, my partner, at some point he said, why don't you take Mirjana Karanović and Marija Škaričić again, because they're so great. And I was like, you're right, it's yes. And then when I called Mirjana, she wasn't very happy that I called her to play a grandmother because, I mean, she was like, it's only you who can call me and ask me to play a grandmother. But I convinced her quickly. And so that's also one thing. You know, in my films, you have always different dialects and languages. And most of the time, the actors don't speak 5 languages and dialects. And so when I have to, for Cure, it was important for me that they have the Dubrovnik dialect, but it wasn't the most important thing. So they went to coaching with a friend of mine who taught them the dialect. But ultimately on set, when it comes down to acting and the emotion, I tell them to forget the dialect and to just be, because that's when they give good performances. Also in my previous film, the actresses don't speak German, but they speak German in the film. So they had to phonetically learn the lines. So I also said, you know, forget it, if you make mistakes, we don't care, because there's things you can really do in post. I mean, you can't start making a film and thinking you can do everything in post, because at some, otherwise you will do post for 2 years and it's boring. But there's, in sound, there's things that can be easily done in post-synchronization. And what I need when I work on set is the emotion and the truth of them and not the perfect dialogue, the dialect. So I will never, you know, say, hey, do it again because you didn't pronounce it perfectly. Mirjana? Mirjana is a very intelligent but also very intuitive person. So her... First she said, no, you know, I'm only going to play it if I get a gray wig. So I said, no, I don't want you to wear a wig and I don't want you to be maquillage, how do you say, makeup, that they make your makeup, that you're 80. Actually, you just be like you are. So that was even worse. And she said, what do you mean? And you know, and then I started talking about my grandmother, and I invited my friend who is from Dubrovnik, who started explaining her how grandmothers are in Dubrovnik, that they have this sense of gentleness, lovingness, but they also, they're the bosses, you know, in the houses, so they can also be very mean. So Mirana is, even if she says, oh, I still this grandmother thing, and you know, look how I look, I'm young, but she starts also like a sponge taking those things, and by in a way having this opposition, she, that's how she, you feed her with things, and she just starts to not identify but to take them in. And then it, even when we before started shooting, in the doing the makeup, the clothes, it, there was still, she was still not quite there with that grandmother. She just said, I really don't understand her. And then I talked to her more, and I realized there's something in her that she just doesn't want to understand her. And then at some point she said that she, because she also trusts me, she said that she just let go. She said, okay, you know, I fought for my wig and for me being 80, but Andrea won. So, and then she really entered as a character with the stuff that I was feeding her with. And also with, you know, reality. I mean, even if she's young, she could be a grandmother. There's different generations of grandmothers. Apart from being a grandmother, she's a person who is dealing with loss in a special way. We all know what loss is. That's again the personal aspect you can kind of carve out in each character or story. And this madness, I try to find images with them or moments, because it's not a film about madness, but all of them are way on a fine line, you know, in between reality, fantasy, being kind of aware of things and totally neglecting them. And then she started finding also her own images about, you know, real pain, suffering, and why you then sometimes kind of click off. But I sometimes also have to just force her to do things, and then, yeah.
This part of her loss and her suffering that is very good depicted, but the part of she being from Dubrovnik, I kind of miss that characterization. It's not just the accent, it's the whole presence and the, maybe that's because I know Granny's from Dubrovnik, but I guess that's I thought that could be like a picture of a town in her presence. So that would be like, I would be interested in it in a way.
But you know, it's I mean, it's my interpretation also of a Dubrovnik grandmother, because I have mine in Dubrovnik, my real grandmother. I kind of have the story I want to tell, and I also have the character of the grandmother also has for in my story a certain not meaning and mission, but a certain position. And in a way it's my vision of the Dubrov granny for this film, so that's it's, there's this, do you know Jonas Mekas, this New York director? When I came to New York, I volunteered at the Anthology Film Archive, and then I also read about what he said, and I drank a lot of vodka with him. It was really funny. And he once said that his friends, when he made his films, they said, you know, in your films, it's so great. It's such a different New York, and we never see that New York. You know, it's full of parks and trees and snow and picnics and family. And then Jonas Mekas' answer was, he said, I'm not filming New York. I'm filming my childhood. It's my New York fiction. And I took that for all my films. Like in Fräulein, it was my Zurich fiction. And Dubrovnik was my Dubrovnik fiction. And because I never lived there, but kind of have a really strong feeling and also opinion about the town, when writing the script, I went to my friends and I gave them the script and I said, you know, I'm interested if Dubrovnik is completely different for you or if you get the atmosphere. And they actually clicked. So I was like, okay.
So, did you manage to stay true to your initial intention of the movie? No, like now that is done and it's cut together. Do you feel it's like what you want it to be?
You know, yes, I did, but it was actually a rather long path with a lot of kind of fighting with myself and refinding it again. It's always been like that in my film. So I start with the initial idea. On the way, for different reasons, I lose it, I find it again, and then on the shoot, usually I feel that I'm close to it, but you also change things and, you know, new things come up. And then in editing, I have to find it again. And then once I found it in editing, I feel when the sound design starts and the music, I lose and find it again. So I sometimes talk to my friend directors and I ask them, are you so complicated like me too? Or do you find it easier? But I think that's one of the most challenging things. And in a way, you have to trust that at the end, it will all come together. But it's a long path where you just have to have faith. And, you know, on the way, obviously, you freak and you think like, oh, shit, what will happen if I completely lose it? I have that fear, for example.